I'm sorry. What we tried to do is get people.
I was kind of conscious because I knew it.
For our signing presentation today, I'd like to introduce John Lee of Xerox Corporation. I'll let John say a little bit about it.
Can you all hear me back there?
No.
I don't usually have a problem filling the room with my voice or my opinion in most cases. I am a Cyclone fan. I do drink beer, so I'm going to get that here soon. So, my name is John Lee. I'm with Xerox Corporation. I'm a program manager with the iGen 3 Digital Production Press Program. That's a mouthful. I'll come up with some acronyms like GAIN and IPMA and PODI and stuff like that as we go through here. We do have a contest on acronyms.
Hey, John. John?
I'm from the Des Moines area. I live here. Yes, sir.
Could I get you to put that microphone on? Because I'm not sure I can get any audio back here.
Well, it's going to be an official record of what I say here.
I'm going to hold you to it, too.
I had a lot of questions during the break on iGen 3. I did not come here to talk about the DocuColor iGen 3 here today. In fact, I think I only have a couple of slides with a picture of the product itself. I did bring some output if anybody's interested in seeing image quality. I know that was one of the questions that came up earlier about image quality. And we can talk about that as we go. My presentation is going to be about 45 minutes. It's more on the business case, the numbers, on how we talk about variable content campaigns. Notice I said variable content, not variable data, not variable information. I'm going to talk about content. It's about having that you talking to me conversation. Which, ironically enough, is kind of how we've been talking to each other in terms of variable content. It's about the message and the conversation you're going to have with an individual. Not a segment, not a group, not a zip code. An individual. So as we go through this, I will show you some examples of what I'm talking about when I talk to you. Because Cindy's interested in something different than Joan. So when I send something to their mailbox, they may not like the same thing. She likes begonias. She likes petunias. Why do I send her the same thing? Maybe you both like both. I don't know anything about you. So I'm going to talk about those things today. I'm going to talk about what's happening, what we see happening in the industry. I do pace a lot. If anyone gets nauseous, I have some Dramamine.
John, I don't think your mic's on. Try that power.
It says on.
Okay.
I am technologically challenged, though, so I haven't figured out how to do my voice mail either. Is that better?
There you go.
Oh,
thank you.
There's too many buttons on it. It's like my cell phone. I can't figure out anything with the talk and the end buttons. I'm going to talk about what we see as trends inside of the one-to-one communication variable content marketplace, trends of what's happening, a lot of which how we touched on. In fact, my presentation is usually 3 hours long. I think I have 5 minutes of material now after Howie. I'm also going to talk about real-life applications that our customers are doing today and show you the business case around those. And I'm going to do some simple math with you that, being from Iowa, this won't be a big deal. Last week I was in Manhattan and Trenton, Pennsylvania and Philadelphia. We had a hard time with simple numbers in some of those cases, so I don't know when I had a problem there. And then I'm going to talk about what we're doing about variable content and why we view ourselves as leading a marketplace, or continuing to lead a marketplace that we actually invented about 12, 13 years ago. And our partnership with folks like Acme, what we're doing and what Acme's doing and the partnership that we bring to the table is not just about a printer, not just about a technology. It's about all the things we do from the front end side to help the programmers, all the things we do on the back side to help with the ease of finishing and distribution and things like that. Let's talk first about what's happening. I am a participatory kind of guy, so I'm going to ask for a little more interaction than Howie got out of you. I know he tried. Raise a hand. How many people have a computer at home? See, Bill Gates was right. A little late, but he was right. How many people here have high-speed internet access at home?
Wow.
How many people have a digital camera? How many people here have a black and white television?
Whoa.
That's not in the basement. I got to see the basement. Oh, it's not in the basement.
It's in the office.
Oh, it's in the office. Okay. Why don't, you know, that's always an interesting question. But okay, so we got computers going for us. We got digital cameras. We got high-speed cable. How many people don't have a computer at home? At all? Okay. How many people use a dial-up line instead of a high-speed movie? I'm just looking at extinction ratios right now. Why do we have high-speed internet access?
Larger files.
Larger files.
Good information.
Speed. I want it now. Gotta have it now, right? Everybody's in competition, I want it now, right? And everything is high-speed file or large files. You go on to MediaCom. How many people use MediaCom? Their welcome page must be about 300K. Right? It's like, oh, all these nice fancy graphics and videos popping up at you. Try that on a dial-up line. I travel a great deal and get that opportunity in my career. I hate to have to use a dial-up line. I want it now. And everybody puts these freaking large graphics on their screens. It takes forever on a laptop when you're on a dial-up line. So my laptops don't work those days. Why do we have color monitors? Color TVs. How many people here have a black and white monitor on their laptop or on their computer? That's not a mainframe. Nobody. Why is that? It costs more. I'd go buy a black and white TV a lot cheaper than a color TV, right? So then why don't we print in color more in digital? Perception is it costs too much, right, Howie? Well, we got this mouse thing in our hand, right? We created a paradigm, if you will, that we refer to as the convergence of technology, where everybody in this room now is a desktop publishing expert, right? You ever send a file to Acme, and they send you back the proof, and it maybe wasn't what you expected?
No.
Never. How many people have downloaded an image off the internet and printed it, and was shocked to find out it was a low-resolution file? Or you sent a file somewhere in email, they printed out, said, I can't even tell what this is. Well, it was too big of a file to email if I kept it in high resolution, right? I got a digital camera that'll do 1280 by whatever, right? But I do it at 640 by 480 because it's a smaller file size, right? And then I print it, and what happens? What's the word I'm looking for? Jaggies. Anybody ever had the jaggies? There is no pill for that. I checked with the pharmacist. There is no pill for the jaggies. We all have a sense of immediacy because we all have access to the internet and that mouse. A few years ago, we launched a product called the DocuTech. Has anybody ever heard of the DocuTech? Anybody here have one? Chuck has his hand up. That's a good sign.
Two.
In this room, I guess he's the one that needs to have one. He's got two. He's got two of them. And we're going for three next month. Is that right? I'm working here, Chuck. We created a marketplace that didn't exist back in 1990 called Print on Demand, right? People used to demand print right now, but there wasn't really print on demand. All print on demand is just-in-time manufacturing of documents. That's all print on demand is. It also allowed us to learn a lot about personalization and content changes in a black-only world, where you would have a four-color shell. Howie had a couple of great examples. You have a four-color shell that you would just change to black text, or maybe you put a half tone on, right? Ginger and I used to work on a project like that a few years ago. But with that mouse now, we also have the added dynamic of I want it now, on top of it, I want it just for me, on top of the fact I can buy print anywhere. I can go online right now and buy print in Singapore and have it here in 7 to 8 weeks from the boat, right? And I can probably get a better price per piece, right? As long as I want to wait 7 to 8 weeks. Right? So we have that technology. Also, the e-commerce side of it means that how many people here actually send PDF files to Acme for printing? Anybody here?
We get them.
You get them.
Yep,
we just don't end up printing.
We did a 302 page book, 52 pages of full color last week.
Wow.
It was all PDF.
All PDF. More and more PDF workflows. So I can now move those files around and take advantage of that. We're also seeing a huge increase in variable content. Why is that? Well, part of it has to do with the discussion I'm going to take you through on that cost per piece instead of cost per lead type of scenario. A lot of it has to do with the technology bringing up to speed. Technologies like DocuColor iGen 3, where you can do press type quality from a digital print engine at economics that weren't available just a few years ago. And I'm not going to get into the sales pitch, but from a quality perspective, 2 years ago, I took R.R. Donnelly, the senior staff, through where we were with the DocuColor iGen 3 at the time. And the chief strategy officer just stopped me right in my tracks. He said, look, would you stop with the image quality stuff? You're there. I'm not going to tell my customer how I produce it. I'm going to give him a variety of different samples, say, at this price point, here's what you can get. At this price point, here's what you can get. At this price point, here's what you can get. I'm not going to tell whether it was done on a cut sheet, a web, an inkjet,
a toner-based device for methamphetamine. That's the conversation you need to have when you talk about what are we going to do with our book of business for marketing. I can do this for you if you do $25,000 and you do a black-only plate change. I can do this for you and we can change everything on the page and it's going to cost you a little bit more per page. Now let me walk you through why that's important. We see all four of these areas as being intertwined. Xerox. We see the ability to leverage today's technology for shorter and shorter runs. How many people here call up Acme and say, hey, Chuck, instead of running $30,000, would you run $50,000 for me? Just because I want some more on my inventory shelves so I can throw them away next year when I go out of them. That ever happened? No, you want less and you want a quicker turn time. Is that fair, what you're asking from Acme? You also want to be able to do it with a lot less pre-press. So let's talk about the trends. Howie talked a lot about CRM, right? Customer relationship management, customer relationship marketing, right? This has been something that's been talked about in the industry for how long? How many people here have access to a PeopleSoft system? How long have you guys had that principle? Been about 4 years now? 4 years. PeopleSoft started up about 9-10 years ago. Their whole mantra is customer relationship management. But if you think about how does it really affect the customer, it doesn't. You're collecting all kinds of data about customers. What are you doing with it? Oh, well, you know, maybe we can send them a different piece with a different look when we do the 50,000 at a time thing. You can do segmentation. You can do focus. You can maybe do a couple other things about why are people buying from you, but you don't communicate any differently to your customers, but you have all this data. I'll give you a story. Rochester, New York. We have a grocery store chain like here in Des Moines, Hy-Vee in Des Moines, right? We have Wegmans in Rochester. The headquarters is in Rochester and everything, right? They have frequent buyer cards, right? They know every time you buy toilet paper, every time you buy disposable wipes for the kids, they know everything you buy and how often you buy it. New stores opening up down in Webster, Tops, right? They're gonna have a grand opening. You know what Wegmans did? They customized their books to the top 50% of their customers of those most frequently purchased items. They gave them a different offer. They said, hey, in the next 2 weeks, you come into the store and spend $50 more, we'll give you 10% off. At the end of the book was a customized coupon book of those things that they were more likely to buy. Tops didn't have a lot of people in the store those first 2 weeks. Loyalty went up, and they could segment out their market and give them an on-demand. That's what customer relationship management, the idea behind it is that I can communicate with Joan on a personal basis. I know what her buying patterns are. She's a customer of mine already. I can have a relationship with her, and I don't have to worry about, well, I might also want to say something that Cindy wants to hear too, so I better not be too specific because I could offend her, or I might not sell you what you really want. I need to have a conversation with one person at a time. That's what customer relationship is supposed to be.
Do you have a handout on these
drafts? Yeah, I do, but too many of you people showed up. What's going on?
We're a little short on them.
There's a couple extras up there.
There you go. Right here. He's got one.
They are also in color, by the way.
I didn't print them.
Is that this is print on demand and you don't have enough to meet the demand?
Anybody else?
Howie mentioned a few times in this presentation the long-term value of a customer. Is anyone here familiar with that formula? How we do long-term valuation of customers? I'll walk you through a simple scenario. In the commercial print world, customer retention is about 80%, right? Means about every year over year they retain about 80% of their customers, 20% of them go somewhere else. It's not too bad, right? Do the math. In 3.1 years, they'll lose half their customers. Half of you will be gone in 3.1 years. That's the lifetime valuation of a customer. Higher your retention rate, the longer your valuation of a customer is. Would we at least all agree this will be the participatory section here? Would we all agree it's cheaper to keep a customer than to find a new one?
No. Yes.
So if I have to turn over half my customers every 3 years, I've got a big problem. I'm always trying to spend more money than I should have to. Again, tying this back to customer relationship management, I know all this information about you, why don't I have a conversation? Back to Howie, are you talking to me? Let's talk about how people get stuff. We talked a lot about the internet. Internet right now, there were the predictions a couple years ago that the internet was going to replace print. We won't have to print anything ever again, right? That's what the number one thing on the internet is. Requests for information. Requests where they give you permission to send them something, right? And what do we do then? We send you the same thing we send to her and to her and to her. Why? You just gave me permission to send you something. How many people here are familiar with the concept of permission marketing? If I give you permission to send me something, shouldn't I send something that is of interest to you? I happen to be a fly fisherman. I will go bait fishing because I have a 7-year-old son and he does like worms. Otherwise, I like to go fly fishing. So then, when Cabela sends me a catalog, and Cabela's happens to be a customer of ours that we're working on this project with, they send me a catalog, they have every item that they've ever sold in fishing that they send to me. Nice big catalog, right? How much does it cost to send that out? What if I just sent John, who's only interested in fly fishing, he knows how to put a worm on a hook already, he doesn't need that other stuff. Or I just send him a catalog half the size. My postage rate probably just went in half. Again, what's the postage going to be in a couple of years?
50 cents.
50 cents. So in my lifetime, it's not going to go down? I'm a young guy. I don't look that way, but I am. Thank you. We have to look at things differently because postal rates aren't going to go down. And I'm going to guess here, how many people here have at least a partial line of sight to the marketing budget? Anybody? Mm-hmm. Are your marketing budgets going to continue to go up with postage rates? No, what happened in the last couple of years with the economy? The cut. My team got cut, and I got a hot product. I got the hottest product inside of Xerox, and I can't spend what I did last year. We are under more and more pressure to spend less and get more out of it, right? So let's talk about that a little bit. What they want? Product literature. Talk about the card campaigns and all these other things. These types of concepts are ubiquitous across all your product lines, whether you're selling financial services, whether you're cross-selling on a financial statement. How many people here in the insurance financial services sector? Think about all the products that you sell today that you could be communicating to people based on information you already have. You know, the size of their portfolio, how much has gone down every month the last couple of months. You know all that stuff. You can market to them differently and cross-sell. Price sheets, all those different things. And when we ask print managers, what's more important in your campaign, internet or print? I should say marketing managers, not print managers. Interesting thing was, remember that I said earlier a couple years ago, everybody said we're not going to print anymore, everything's going to be on the web, right? Now we're again talking about that cross-selling, the integrated campaigns, where we have print, we have direct mail, we have TV, we have radio, right? And when we combine those two, that's a lot more important. Just a little trivia. Major soft drink beverage manufacturer headquartered in Atlanta, Georgia with red colors. Anybody got a quote for me? Recently announced to us that they're considering pulling all national TV advertising. Can you imagine that? No more Coca-Cola? Like the Super Bowl? Or is that Pepsi? Why would they do such a thing? They can't quantify the results. There's no ROI. Nobody can sit here and tell me, how many cans of Coke did we sell by running that $3 million ad? Can't do it. We need to get into that business case. We need to look at what it does in the cross-media to drive other business and quantify it. We have to be able to measure results. No longer can you have that $3 million advertising budget and say, hey, just let me know how much I need to order for cars next week. We have to quantify what our return is. Even when the economy picks up, you think this is going to change? Oh no, you're all of a sudden, hey, the economy picked up, here's an extra $200,000 for your campaign. We've learned now to live on less, haven't we? And postage rates are not going to get any better. So what we're saying is, we need to have a balance. It's not just print, it's not just direct mail, it's not just radio, it's not just advertising. I heard someone mention earlier, what do you see on the radio? You see a pull to a website. What do you get at the website? You get permission to market to them. If they show up at your website from the radio ad, you all of a sudden have permission to share information with them. If you ask them for some more probing information, you can now segment them, right? That's really where we come into the database side is, all right, I'm going to do the same piece, I'm just going to segment my database because I can't change the print, right? So that's what we do. We don't print the same thing. This will give you the opportunity to integrate that campaign. It is not a replacement for any other individual component. Howie shared some of these numbers as well. Why color? And we talked about black and white TVs. And I'm glad yours is plugged in and operational, by the way. I have a black and white TV. We've been trying to sell it in the garage sale, nobody will buy it. I don't have a black and white monitor for my computer anymore. Somebody did buy that. I don't know what they're going to use it for. Maybe they'll send it to Angola or something. We don't do black and white anymore. You don't see black and white billboards. You don't see black and white web pages. When's the last time you saw a text-oriented black and white web page? When the web first came out, that's all it was, right? Don't do that anymore. Comprehension is higher, retention, everything. In fact, when we do these studies that show retention and response rates, one of the things that we do a lot of statement printing for financial companies, bills. Right? You get a bill. You ever get a bill that has red on it? Like calling attention, payment due by? Our studies show that your response rate is 33% better if we put just a red block on it telling you when your payment is due. What is that worth for a cash flow? A company that's got a $6 million a week float in money, if I take 2 days out of it, I can save them $1 million a week just in float. Now, this is going to go back to my common theme. At that point in time, is it a cost per piece discussion? No, it's a return on investment. You will not do digital printing at the same price you will do offset cut sheet. You will not, and nor should you. And I hope that we never come up with a product that allows you to do that. There's too much value to it. We did a study, actually Frank Amano did a study with one of his graduate students, and I know that you alluded to parts of it. We did a study to quantify the effects of variable content and full color. Something that, you know, people like me were going to stand up and talk about this until we're blue in the face for years. But now they actually went out and said, okay, what if we do a blind study? They took a document and they sent it out just a static black-only document, right? Nothing changed on it. And they got, you know what, 1-2% response rate, right? Average. They went and they added just a little bit of variable content to it. Like on a DocuTech where you added, Dear Mr. Lehman. That's all they did to it. They got an increase of 44% on the response rate. Pretty good, huh? Anybody got a calculator? What is 44% increase of 1.5%? It's cracky, technically, sorry. Sorry for the slang, but it's not. That's not very good, so why would I do that? Interesting thing, we took that same black-only document and all we did was turn it into color. Didn't add any variable to it. Got an increase of 45%. Almost the same as adding black variable. So then why would we do color? It's too expensive, right? If we add variable to the color piece, though, now we're going to talk about some numbers. We're going to talk about an increase of 135% just by adding some variable to a color page. We're still leaving money on the table. The real money, the real power is, what if I can use that technology, that CRM information I already have? That's kind of cool. And tailor my message to a communication, a conversation with one individual. I get an increase of 500% if I do that. Now, if I increase my response fivefold, now I've got a discussion point, right? And we've got all this information about our customers now. Not all of you know the information or who owns it, but it's somewhere. Somebody has information. You know, Principal Financial Group's got more data about me than I probably know myself. You know, my father worked there for 30-some years. I've been a customer of theirs for 20-some years. I'm sure they could look up and tell you exactly when I went from diapers to regular pants. I don't know. But they know everything about me. They aren't using it, though. They're not using it. If I also take in, and we all agree the postage rates are going to go up, I need to cut through some noise, right? How many people have electronic mail at home? How many people have more than one email account at home? Why is that?
I surf on one account.
You surf on one, because so you know that's where all the garbage is going to go, right? So you have one that you give to people you trust and one that you might fill out on a website because you know all the spam is going to hit you, right? Spam, what a nice way to, what a knock on spam. I get spam on a daily basis. Hourly basis. I got a BlackBerry, I've had 15 spam messages just since I got here, you know? It's all over the place. All right, how many people surf the web? Safe question. How many people get pop-ups? What is that? I'm sitting on here doing my little, you know, Google.com thing and boom, 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 boom. Would you like to go to Tahiti for 50% off this week? I'm not a Tahiti fan. What are you talking to me? Blasting stuff. But you know what? I can filter that stuff, can't I? Mr. Popper Stopper. If you haven't got it on your computer, go get Mr. Popper Stopper. It's the best $10 you're going to spend. It'll turn all those things off. It'll actually, you can set it up so it can actually come up and say, somebody's trying to send you a pop-up window. Do you want it or not? You can say no and don't ever let me see that guy again. Spam. I can put filter in my email now to clear out the spam. But you know what? If I put something in your mailbox, you got to touch it. By law, if I put it in your mailbox, you've got to touch it. So while technology is giving me the ability to automatically start blasting information out, technology also gives me the opportunity to turn it all off. If I put it in your mailbox, you've got to touch it. Now my challenge is, how do I talk to you? How do I cut through the noise? How do I get to the point where, one of the studies we did with DMA was touch points. How many times does a piece get touched, right? Guess what, the average is 1.2. You take it out of the mailbox, right? There's one. You go over to the nice big brown file in the kitchen. Nope, 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 nope. How many people here open their mail over the trash can? Chuck didn't. He sends most of the stuff. The truth of the matter is we throw most of that stuff away. How many people throw their cell phone bills away? I wish I had that bravery. What we found is if we use statements for cross-selling, we use a little more personal conversation about what your preferences are, what you like. I can have a conversation with Ginger. I send her stuff of things that she's interested in. She's more likely to keep that and touch it a couple times. Guess what the average number of touch points on a financial statement, like a cell phone bill, is? 3.5. I'm a marketer. I want somebody to touch my message 3.5 times, don't you? So why don't I use that as a tool to market them? We also did a little bit of study here on VI promos versus non-VI promos. Interesting thing we ran out here was the response time. If I gave a variable promotion to Cindy, she responded quicker. Not just more likely to respond, but in a quicker time frame. Again, it goes back to that flow. What if I'm a financial company and I'm charging money? And I want you to give me that money quicker. If I get my money quicker, it's worth something, isn't it? Those are conversations we have to have with the financial and the marketing people in our organizations. We need to do a better job of educating the marketplace. This can be done. I did some simple math. And again, nobody here from Trenton, is there? You know how many streets are named Woodbridge in Trenton, New Jersey? Oh my God. I took a campaign, a marketing campaign, of $100,000. This is not in your slides, so you have to actually bear me out. Anybody got a calculator? Chuck does. I know he always does.
Don't, actually.
I'm going to say I have a campaign, a budget, right? Everybody has a budget. You can run the numbers. I have a marketing campaign budget this year, right? You can't spend any more. And oh, by the way, I'd like you to take 10% out of it. Ever hear that one? No, that only happens to me. All right, so if I do a traditional mail piece and it costs me 35 cents a piece with postage, fair? Okay. 35 cents a piece of postage. That means for my $100,000, I can send out 285,714 pieces in the mail. Right? With me so far? This is not in part. You did a good job. How are you changing? All right? And I get a 1.5% response rate. Fair? Average? I'm trying to be conservative here. I get then roughly 4,300 leads back out of my mailing. Okay? If I take that $100,000, that gives me, correct my math if I'm wrong, about $23 per lead it cost me to do that mailing. Fair? So I need to be selling something that costs more than 23 bucks, I suppose, right? And have a 100% close rate, by the way. Let's not forget close ratios, Howie. We don't talk about close ratios. We need to. If I do a variable content job, and now again, I did spend an extensive amount of time in Ames. Yes, I was on that 8-year plan. Okay, no, no, no. 1 year on, 1 year off. My cost per piece is going to be more. Let's say it's 60 cents, including postage. You are not going to do variable content mail for less than you're doing just standard stuff, right? So since it costs me more, I'm only going to send out 167,000 pieces in the mail, okay? Significantly less. Would you agree? Based on Howie's numbers, I'm being conservative. I tell you, you can expect a 5% response rate, okay? Fair? 5% response rate means you're going to get 8,300 leads back. 8,300 leads back. I'm spending the same money, right? My cost per lead is 12 bucks. That's the discussion we have to have when we're talking about why do we want to do digital, why do we want to focus, why do we want to target, why do we want to cut through the noise in the mailbox. The mailbox, by law, is going to be the only vehicle that you still have to touch from a communications medium. How many people here have TiVos at home? Anybody? All right, I am the biggest geek in town. Let me give you a synopsis here. 23 versus 12 bucks, cost per lead, cost per piece, right? 35 cents versus 60 cents, but it's the cost per piece discussion. Let's take it one step further. It's 194% increase in leads. Let's say I got a 25% close ratio. I got a more qualified prospect. I'm probably going to get better than 25%, right? Because they responded. And I qualified them before I sent them anything, right? Let's say conservatively I got a 25% close ratio. On the traditional way, I get about 1,000 people that I'm going to close for business. I got 2,000 people, almost twice as many of the variable content with the same close ratio. Take that to a revenue. Go to your revenue people, your marketing people, say, what does this mean to you from a revenue perspective? If my product price is $100, my gross revenue would be $107,000. If my product price was $100, it's going to be $200,000. Just on this little swing here, I almost doubled my revenue for the same marketing campaign budget. That's the conversation we want to have and educate the marketplace. The technology now is here to do this. We couldn't do this a few years ago, we just couldn't. The technology now is there to enable the image transfers, the ability to say, you know, if I'm close to retirement, I can put a different picture on the front than somebody who just had a baby. I have a customer in Chicago, Illinois. I can find it here. I have a customer in Chicago, Illinois, who did a pilot. I'm going to call it a pilot. It was not a no charge. It was a let's do this job. Here's what it's going to cost. If it works, we're going to go forward. I can't do jobs today with the economy prolonged. And these guys cost me a lot of money. All right, so we got to have something in it to make sure we're covering something. These folks were sending out direct mail piece. This was a mammogram reminder from a physician to a patient. Okay? You get this note from your doctor reminding you got an appointment coming up, yada yada yada. It's a standard 4/1 postcard, right? Look, you know, getting this kind of stuff from your doctors, your dentists and stuff all the time, right? They were getting about a 2.5% response rate. Pretty good, huh? 2.5% direct mail piece? Would you agree that's pretty good?
Yeah.
Did I use the word cracking before? This is a personal note from your physician to you about a critical health care issue, and 2.5% of the time you actually go and do something about it? That's not good. So what they did is they said, let's do a pilot here. Because if you're 25 years old, you may not be able to see this. If you're 25 years old, you may not pay much attention to this postcard. I'm guessing you don't. If you are 85 years old, you may not really get into the aerobics one either, right? But what if you know all this information about your patients, you know how old they are, when they were in last, who their doctor is, where they live, you know all this stuff. CRM, right? You know all this stuff. Why don't you use it? So why don't you put a more age-specific photo on the front of the postcard? Pretty cool, huh? That would be enough to drive up response rate. Oh, let's bump that up a little bit. How about a note with a picture of the physician on the inside? Again, explaining why it's important that you come in and remind you, hey, it's been a while since I've seen you last, yada, yada, yada. Oh, by the way, a different offer. You're new to the neighborhood. New to the neighborhood, here's a map to the local clinic. Different offer based on, you know that they've not been into your clinic before, here's a new opportunity, they just moved into the neighborhood, you buy these lists, right? I've probably used this story in the last year 1,000 times, and I was back with the actual owner of the company once, and he said, you know what, you're missing the whole thing. This customer was spending about 30, 35 cents a postcard when he first started doing it. They were sending out about 5,000 of these reminders a week in the Chicago area. They now spend a dollar a piece, almost triple the cost, right? They get a 45 to 50% response rate. Oh, that's not the cool part. You know what the cool part is? Sorry about this, but every time a lady walks in for a mammogram, the doctor makes $100 profit in his pocket. They got a 50% response rate. Every time I send one of these out, I get 50 bucks. Is that dollar really important now? It cost me a dollar to send it out. I'm going to get 50 bucks back. Print more. That's the conversation we need to have internally as to what is the importance of leveraging the data that we have and having a personal conversation with the person that's going to open this piece. Because they got to touch it. It's in the mailbox, right? I hadn't figured out how to train my dog to get the mail out of the post office. Let's talk about some of these other hot applications and what they're doing. Where they're happening most, and it's funny, we learned a lot about what we need to be focusing on at Xerox. It's not about talking to people like Chuck at Acme Printing. It's talking to people like you. We need to educate creative agencies. How many people here are from ad agencies or creative agencies? We need to educate people like you that you can do this. Right? That you can do this. And where are those applications at? For you to focus on, it's going to be an industrial manufacturing car. We have a couple of major car manufacturers that are using this technology today. It's all web-enabled, all web-fulfilled. There's no pre-press. It's all technology-based. Comes right out and gets put in the mail. And they sold how many more millions of dollars worth of cars? $400 million worth of cars. $500 million. That's some serious money. I'm in the wrong business. Marketing people inside your organizations are where the biggest influence is. What I would ask, I mean, how many people here are part of marketing departments? You and the creative agencies, the ad agencies, are where we're focusing our efforts on educating. We're not trying to sell you anything. We're trying to educate you the fact that you can do this. There's a way to do this. And with partnerships with people like Acme, the tools are out here to do this. You just got to know that if you want to offer to your customers a competitive advantage, how to sort through the noise, how to have a conversation with me so I don't throw your mail away, we can do it today. Today. I'm not going to get into too much of the categories of variable content print because I know how we went through a lot of this, but I do want to show a couple of different things. These are your handouts as well. For those of you who I decided to give you handouts, a demand for print. I'm going to cut down to what we're doing. Howie gave better examples than I did anyway, although I can print it, he has better ideas, right? What did Xerox do about variable content? Well, we actually have internally some difficulty in internalizing how to do this ourselves. Anybody, I use a phrase, I don't know if you want to use it or not, you probably won't, but eat your own dog food. Do you do it yourself? Chuck does. They're doing it more and more inside of Acme, eating their own dog food, using the technology to say, hey, you know what, we can do this, and I'm doing it right now. In fact, Salt Lake City Olympics, we ran some ads during Salt Lake City. I'm going to show you one of those videos right now, and I'm going to tell you two funny stories out of it. Here's an ad we ran at Salt Lake City Winter Olympics.
We go through this every time. Red.
Blue.
Leather.
Cloth.
Whoa, now that's a car.
No, that's my car. I built it on the web, and they sent me that the next day. Printed and personalized. My color, my interior, where to go. They even gave me a free CD player. It can be here in a week.
Well, at least we talked about it.
I was in Trenton, New Jersey last week. Talking to my wife, she said, "Hey, I found this new patio set on the web." "Really? Tell me about it." "Oh, it'll be here tomorrow. You have to pick it up when you get home." When we ran this in the year 2000, two funny things happened. First, we got a lot of phone calls from people. "How did you do that?" Which the funny part of the story is that there were only about three people inside of Xerox that even knew you could do that. We weren't doing it. We weren't doing customized brochures or anything like that. So all of a sudden we got these marketing people out there telling people, and we're scrambling saying, "You can do that?" The second thing that happened there is that people called and they weren't calling us about buying stuff. They wanted to know who to get it done. That was a big red light. As also justification from some of our people in our marketing group saying we need to educate the print influencers, not the print buyers. If you're a marketing or advertising agency, you're an influencer. You may also have responsibility for buying, but you get to communicate to the designers and the people that come up with the campaigns who don't know you can do this. And you can do it today. So my task in life now is to educate everybody that this is cool and you ought to do it. What do you think? We had a CEO of Merck gave us a great quote. We refined it a little bit and had him change it because it was kind of crude, but in essence, it's he who has the data wins. You have more data about your customers than you even know about. If you're an ad agency or marketing agency, you probably have someone on site already that's doing database management. And they're just trying to keep it small and compact, and you have no idea what, if anything, is ever going to get done with the truth. My task to you is go back and say, okay, we got all these gigabytes and terabytes of information. What are we doing with it? We can do something with it. We can have a conversation with our customers. Inside of Xerox, we look at it in a variety of different ways. We don't look at it just as a product. I have not talked about products so far in my presentation, have I? Really? I brought some stuff in case somebody wants to see some image quality things, because that used to be the big pushback is, well, image quality isn't there. I would ask if, of all of you here, is image quality acceptable? I agree with Howie. And, you know, there's going to be things you can do on press you'll never do on a digital engine, unless you want to pay $48 a sheet. I'm guessing that might be outside the range of the elasticity for the price of that sheet. Anybody here want to pay $48 for one sheet? Probably not. Even the people selling $100,000 Mercedes won't pay $100 for those marketing fees, by the way. So we see it as being more holistic. It's more about the workflow, about the design, about educating. We see it as being holistic. In 1990, we launched DocuTech. It created an industry called print on demand. But if you really peel back why we created DocuTech, it was for selfish reasons. It wasn't to create an industry or marketplace. It was to lessen the number of moving parts so it would be cheaper to service, truth be told. We also knew that eventually Bill Gates would be right and everybody would have a computer. So we wanted to have an engine that you could actually use for digital publishing. DocuTech, to date, we've got over 30,000 DocuTechs installed worldwide. The actual product lifecycle projection is 15,000 machines. DocuTech continues to grow. But when we look at what else we've done in the industry, we launched a product in 1995. I happen to have the great honor of being on this product launch team called the DocuColor 40. Anybody ever hear of a DocuColor 40? It was okay. Had decent quality if you weren't running a lot of it. It was okay. You would not send the output to a customer in direct mail. It would have cost you a couple dollars a page to do it because you would have had to put some laminate on it or some kind of funky stuff there. It was not very efficient. A couple of years ago, we launched a product called the DocuColor 2000. Some of you have DocuColor 2000s. Our principal has several of them. It was the first time that we had graphic arts type quality in a production environment that you could actually have, from an economic standpoint, the ability to cost justify. This last year, we launched a product that was codenamed FutureColor. There were about eight other codenames before that, but Future Color is what we launched at Drupa. iGen 3, DocuColor iGen 3. For the first time, this is what people referred to in the past as the color DocuTech. The ability to run millions of pages a month on a digital cut sheet device that was not a press. To get graphic arts type things involved. Here's my unabashed commercial. Amen. All right, I'm done. Our goal here was to take that digital black and white world, right? The DocuTech POD, and create it to digital color. Just like that, was that kind of cool? Okay. Ooh. All right, I'm done. Remember we talked about that long-term valuation of customers? How long before I lose half my customers at 80% retention? 3.1 million. Doesn't that scare you? Financial services and banking industry has become a commodity product. Would you agree with me?
No.
I can, no? Oh, yes. I can research everything, I can apply online, I can do all kinds of things without ever having to talk to a financial services representative. I can buy stocks online without any, advice. We have to treat our customers differently. We have to up that percentage. The only way to do that is have a conversation one person at a time. It's the only way to do it. And I have to figure out how I touch it. We look at it more than just print. We have a variety of solutions partners that we work with that are all industry standard. No more of this proprietary stuff. We've got stuff that integrates into the web, into finishing, into workflow, into design, into Quark. All kinds of different things. All of which Chuck and these guys can talk you through how to do that in their shop. It's all about standards now, right? As long as it works for you. It's great to be a standard. That's my story. My emphasizing points are, take a look at image quality if you get a chance. Talk about the cost per lead and what it does from a revenue perspective. Just do some simple math for your people saying, I don't have to send all those pieces out. Why are you spending more and more money on postage? What kind of ROI is there on postage, people? There's no ROI on postage. So if it keeps going up, you gotta find something else, right? So that's my message to you. Thanks. Questions and answers, but I've decided that there's too many Hawkeye fans in here, so I'm not taking any questions. I'm just kidding. My father's at the University of Iowa. I was in Bettendorf yesterday, and I used that line and I got people throwing stuff at me. Any questions about anything I presented today or discussion topics? Howie's still here and he's still awake, which is amazing to me. Anything anybody want to talk about? This is a good time to do it. All right, I'm German. I'll fill the bar.
All right, John, thank you very much. Well, thank you all for coming today. We have just a couple little points of business here before we dismiss for the day. And by golly, we got you out an hour early. That's a really unusual little print production, right? Gets you something early. Oh, I don't know how to handle that. Okay, so everybody's got their name in here, right? No? Oh, it's your last chance. Got a registration card here for you. So, are you sure nobody has any questions while we pause right here? There's an evaluation form. It should have been the pack of materials on your desk. We'd really appreciate you to fill that out. We do these customer seminars for your benefit. It's important for us to know how we did and what's important to you. And if you can just leave them on the table on your way out, face down if you want, or on the table where you're at, we'll get them picked up. Okay?
Do a big camera.
I have a couple questions up
there. All right, round and round we go.
All right.
The winner is Gene McClain. One other little thing I want to mention, it's kind of a minor deal, you might think, but Acme Printing, as you know, is a leader in technology and in process, and our goal is to help you grow your business and be successful, because we know the only way we'll ever be successful is if we can help you with your business be successful. Acme Printing does have on order the latest technology in digital printing press production, the iGen 3. Our delivery and in service. Our actual delivery time and in-service date on that is still in flux, but keep an eye on our Digital Informer and other newsletters, so we'll be announcing that as soon as we get that firmed up. And I hope you've all had a very good afternoon and learned a lot, and I appreciate your business and your time here today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Valley. There we go.
Well, you know, you're pretty...
Well, I guess, you guys, I congratulate you on finishing early, however, I feel like joining you in progress, and it's...
Sorry about that.
But the outcome of the first time, I thought...